Hello there, everyone. Now, what you're about to watch is the first installment of the Jeffrey Epstein saga. The original video was deleted by YouTube for reasons of harassment, threats, and cyberbullying. Now, I don't know who YouTube thinks I was threatening, harassing, or cyberbullying. That wasn't my intention at all. The only people that come to mind are these folks. I think these are the people YouTube thinks I was cyberbullying. Oops! Now, if my video is going to get deleted for those reasons, for cyberbullying, then why is this video of Tucker Carlson calling General Mark Milley, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, a pig and stupid, still up on YouTube? Check it out.
He's not just a pig, he's stupid. So Mark...
What the hell, YouTube? He just called him a pig and stupid. That's cyberbullying. It's got 1.3 million views. Are you guys going to take it down? No, I don't think you are. Because it's Fox. And Fox is mainstream, baby. YouTube loves the mainstream media. They love the status quo, and they love the establishment. And they also love squashing independent media wherever they see fit. They're super hypocritical. Super selective, and it wouldn't surprise me if they take this video down as well. But please, for the love of God, YouTube, keep it up. Because this story is the story that everyone wants to hear. And it doesn't matter how much you suppress it or ban it, people are going to search it out and they're going to find it. Did you guys know that almost every Jeffrey Epstein video up on YouTube is instantly demonetized? I can't make money off of this even if I wanted to, but that's not why I do this. I do this because this is a story that everyone wants to hear. Straight up. And without further ado, enjoy. Hall of eyeballs, a chandelier with a human-sized mannequin hanging from it, a chessboard that had pieces resembling his staff in their underwear, this portrait of Bill Clinton. A stuffed poodle on top of a piano. A giant desk that could fit 20 people. He also had a shit ton of computer monitors on that desk and a phone. A ginormous statue of a naked African warrior that was twice the size of a regular person. A statue of a dog that was right next to a statue of dog turds. On one of his walls, he had a photorealistic mural of a prison. And at the center of that mural was him. And he had that done after he got out of jail the first time to remind himself that he can go back to jail whenever. A copy of the book, The Misfortunes of Virtue, a book by the very first sadist ever, the Marquis de Sade. And last but not least, pictures of him with a bunch of famous people, like this guy. The floors appeared to be made out of wood and were covered with a large oriental rug. The interior had two levels. To the right was a gray sofa. Directly ahead was a desk about 10 feet long made of dark wood. Behind the desk were several columns of floor-to-ceiling bookcases. The bookcases went high enough to require a ladder, but there was no fucking ladder. To the left was a small black grand piano. And above this piano hung a portrait of him with the Pope, specifically Pope John Paul II. What the fuck? Alright folks, we got a possible bombshell concerning Ghislaine Maxwell coming next week. Here, I'll move my head so you can get a better look. I do suggest you look up this article and read it for yourself. I actually suggest you do that with everything I talk about here on this account. Okay, so let me tell you why this is a big deal. A detailed view of the contents of Jeffrey Epstein victim Virginia Roberts Giuffre's defamation lawsuit against Ghislaine Maxwell will be unsealed next week.
The documents supply context and filigree detail of the inner workings of Epstein's operations. The documents include the transcript of Ghislaine Maxwell's own 7-hour deposition, which runs at 400 pages. Oh my God, what did she talk about? This could be huge. So stay tuned and come back next week. I'll give you the deets. This painting was painted by Petrina Ryan-Cleed, and she completed the work while she was an MFA student at the New York Academy of Art. The name of the painting is Parsing Bill, and it was painted alongside another painting of George W. Bush, where it had him playing with Jenga towers. This is that painting of Bush. It's important to note, though, that this painting was not found in Jeffrey Epstein's home, only the one of Bill Clinton. Both paintings were statements on the presidents and the darkest times of their presidency, with Jenga representing 9/11 and the blue dress and red shoes representing Monica Lewinsky. The painting was sold at the Tribeca Ball in 2012 for $1,300. Ryan Cleed had no idea Epstein had the painting until the scandal broke out. And reportedly, this painting was the first thing you saw when you walked into Epstein's mansion. Yo, so I googled Epstein's flight logs, and one of the top results was this list on Reddit. I'm just going to tell you guys right now, this list seems fake. I wouldn't trust it. I would trust this article on Reuters. It's a fact check on whether or not Tom Hanks was on the flight logs, and they found that he wasn't. Reuters does have a link to all the flight logs, and if you look really closely, you can see a Mr. Bill Clinton right there. Right there. Look at that. Business Insider has a searchable database, but you gotta pay in order to use it. And Business Insider also has an article that shows that, oh, look who else was on the flight logs. Hello there, everybody. So I found something. I googled Epstein's little black book, and I found this database that contains all 1,576 names that were in Epstein's little black book. I tried typing in some names that we all know, and voila! There we go. Here are the results. Booyah! The pages seem to be photocopies of the actual book. I tried typing in Chris Tucker's name because he hung out with Epstein a lot for some reason. And there you go. There's his info. Why Chris Tucker? Why? I also tried typing in Courtney Love's name because she's in the book for some reason. And yeah. So try playing around with this website yourself. Let's see what we can find. Jeffrey Epstein used to teach math at the Dalton School in New York. The guy who hired Epstein, even though Epstein dropped out of college and was only 21 years old at the time, was Donald Barr, the father of Attorney General William Barr. Epstein would be let go and Donald Barr would resign as headmaster in 1974. In 1973, though, he wrote a book called Space Relations. Get this. Space Relations is a science fiction novel about a planet ruled by oligarchs who perform child sex slavery. Doesn't that sound familiar? Fast forward 46 years into the future, Jeffrey Epstein is taken into custody and Bill Barr is the Attorney General of the Department of Justice. Epstein commits suicide under Barr's watch and Barr removes the U.S. Attorney on Epstein's case. Hey Bill, what are you hiding? Ghislaine Maxwell's documents have been unsealed. You can find the documents on this Reddit post by hitting this link right here. You hit that link, it'll take you to all 2,024 pages. God damn. On the same thread, you'll find another link that'll take you to a breakdown people are doing on Reddit right there. This is the breakdown. Now, when it comes to these documents, I wouldn't want to be Alan Dershowitz right now. Why? Because of this. I also wouldn't want to be Bill Clinton. Why? Because of this. That's a U.S. president. Epstein update. So, I want to clarify a few things. The unsealed documents that were released yesterday were not Ghislaine Maxwell's deposition. That was Virginia Giuffre's deposition. She's one of Epstein's victims. There's still a lot of damning things within that deposition. Maxwell's deposition was supposed to come out this coming Monday, but delay granted. What do I think about this? I think this is bullshit. Fuck the Second Circuit. We deserve to see what this bitch had to say. Alan Dershowitz is a prominent American lawyer. He used to teach law at Harvard and was actually the youngest guy to ever teach law there. He started teaching at 28 years old. Alan Dershowitz is a pretty successful lawyer, especially when it comes to murder or attempted murder cases, winning 13 out of 15 of them in his career. Alan Dershowitz was actually a part of the legal dream team that got OJ acquitted. He was also a part of Trump's defense team when he got impeached. The documents unsealed a couple of days ago reveals that Epstein and Dershowitz were close friends. Dershowitz was actually able to get Epstein immunity from criminal prosecution. Dershowitz was actually able to get that sort of immunity for all of Epstein's co-conspirators, which included Dershowitz as well. Alan Dershowitz is a sex offender. Fuck him and anybody associated with him. According to unsealed documents, Virginia Giuffre was forced to have sexual relations with all of these men. Very powerful men. Prince Andrew, the Duke of York. This guy is the third child of Queen Elizabeth II. He's a part of the royal family, and I suggest you watch that interview he did where he completely embarrasses himself. The cringiest shit in the world. This guy is Glenn Dubin, a hedge fund manager, basically another one of Epstein's really rich friends. Bill Richardson, the former governor of New Mexico. He actually served in the Obama administration as Secretary of Commerce. Jean-Luc Brunel. This guy ran a modeling agency and he actually supplied Epstein with some of his victims. This goofy looking motherfucker is Marvin Minsky. He was a pioneer in artificial intelligence and he was actually one of the co-founders of MIT. Wow. I'd like to make a correction, you guys. Minsky did not found MIT, the whole school. He founded the AI laboratory at the school. Sorry, I misread that. Actually, that's inaccurate too. I actually don't know how to read. Now, I already told you about how Alan Dershowitz was able to get him and Epstein immunity from criminal prosecution through something called an NPA, a non-prosecution agreement. A U.S. prosecutor would have to agree to this. And who's the prosecutor that let this happen? A fucker by the name of Alexander Acosta. This is the guy that gave Epstein his sweetheart deal and basically let Epstein avoid any serious jail time. And he was able to keep this a secret, never letting any of Epstein's victims know, which was a violation of the Crime Victims' Rights Act. And Alexander Acosta was disbarred and never allowed to practice law ever again. Wrong! Wrong! In 2017, he became Trump's labor secretary. And in 2019, he resigned when the Epstein case blew up. I got two questions concerning this fuckface. Why would he let a pedophile walk and why would anybody hire him? The suicide that launched a thousand memes. Jeffrey Epstein was arrested on July 6, 2019 on sex trafficking charges. He was jailed at the Metropolitan Correctional Center in New York City. On July 23, 2019, Epstein was found unconscious in his jail cell with injuries to his neck. Epstein believed his cellmate tried to kill him, while the staff there said he attempted suicide. 6 days later, Epstein was taken off of suicide watch and transferred to another housing unit with another inmate. At this housing unit, a guard was supposed to look into the cell every 30 minutes. On August 10, 2019, this did not happen. The guards who were watching Epstein apparently fell asleep and did not check on him for 3 hours. Two cameras in front of Epstein's cell malfunctioned that night, and at 6:30 a.m. he was found dead. Suicide these nuts. Epstein's autopsy was performed on August 11, 2019. The autopsy found multiple breaks in his neck bones. One bone they found to be broken was the hyoid bone. Now that bone can break when somebody hangs themselves, but that kind of break is more common in victims of homicide by strangulation. On August 16, 2019, Jeffrey Epstein's death was ruled a suicide by a New York medical examiner. Apparently, the medical examiner arrived at that conclusion after watching 9 minutes of security cam footage from one of the same security cams that broke that night. Epstein's lawyers decided to have their own autopsy, so they hired notable forensic pathologist Michael Baden to perform an independent one. What did Michael Baden find? Well, he found that the injuries to Epstein's neck were more in line with homicide by strangulation than suicide by hanging. After leaving his teaching job at Dalton School, Jeffrey Epstein began to work in finance. Epstein was a relatively unknown, inexperienced financial consultant until 1986. That's when he met Les Wexner, the CEO of L Brands, the owners of Victoria's Secret. Within a year, Epstein became Wexner's financial advisor and his right-hand man. People close to Wexner, colleagues and friends, were surprised by this. Epstein was a nobody from nowhere. In 1991, Wexner granted Epstein power of attorney, which let Epstein oversee most of Wexner's finances. And that's how Epstein got so rich. He got everything from Wexner. Nobody knows why Wexner gave Epstein so much. Some people think they were lovers, others think that Wexner was blackmail victim number one. A couple of months into dating Epstein, Ghislaine Maxwell hired Christopher Mason to write Epstein a song for his 40th birthday. Mason was supposed to sing the song in front of everybody at Epstein's birthday party. This song is odd because of all of the weird things Ghislaine wanted Mason to put into the song, like references to all of the high school girls that had crushes on Epstein when he taught at Dalton, and Epstein's 24-hour erections. Being the diligent songwriter that he was, though, Mason wrote the song and he sang it at Epstein's party that was attended by 7 people, one of those people being Les Wexner. Here is a transcript of that creepy-ass song. 24-hour erections. He taught at Dalton, the naughty boy blushes, to think of the schoolgirls and all of their crushes. What? We got some new weird details, folks. And they are, how do you say, the opposite of pleasant. Apparently, Ghislaine Maxwell used to boast about performing oral sex on George Clooney. George, my guy, you got some explaining to do. Ghislaine Maxwell once thought that a young Paris Hilton would be perfect for Jeffrey Epstein. That's not hot. And last but not least, apparently Prince Andrew allegedly used a puppet of himself to grope victims at Jeffrey Epstein's house. So imagine being groped by this guy, and also being groped by an Elmo Sesame Street version of this guy. Gross! These people are so evil! When Jeffrey Epstein was arrested in 2019, Donald Trump asserted that yes, he had met Epstein and knew him, but he wasn't a fan of his, and a Trump Organization official also said that Jeffrey Epstein was never a member of Mar-a-Lago. Now, is this true? No. New information in the book The Grifters Club reveals that Jeffrey Epstein was in fact a member of Mar-a-Lago up until 2007. That's when he hit on another member's teenage daughter and was banned. This would mean that Trump and his organization lied about Epstein being a member. Again, let me reference this quote Trump made in New York Magazine back in 2002, where he says he's known Jeffrey for 15 years, and he insinuates that Epstein had a penchant for children. You have to understand, Trump doesn't lie to kick it, he lies to save his ass. Jeffrey Epstein purchased Little St. James in 1998 for $7.95 million. According to court filings, locals dubbed the island Pedophile Island and Orgy Island. The island had a staff of 70 and 5 buildings, a villa-style compound, a library, a cinema, a detached bathhouse, and cabanas. And there was even a flamingo-stocked lagoon. Fancy. Everybody knows about that stone temple that apparently had a door that was designed to keep people inside. But there were other buildings like these quarters that were built for the maids. There were even buildings still under construction. Lots of odd things populated the island, like this large solar clock and these plastic cows that were moved daily by staff. The island was also designed to be difficult to escape from. It's been a full calendar year since Jeffrey Epstein committed suicide. Let's look at some recent updates. Looks like Ghislaine's trying to halt the release of more sealed documents as critical new information has come up. I wonder what this critical new information is, and I hope it's available to the public real soon. Ghislaine's also asking to be moved to general population while in prison. Now, I don't know about this. This sounds like someone's trying to get suicided. If she is moved and anything happens to her, rest assured, there will be hell to pay. And finally, it seems like Les Wexner, Epstein's sugar daddy, is gonna have to explain himself in court real soon. It's been a year. This is probably the biggest story ever, and nobody wants to talk about it. Not the media, not the president. But you know who wants to talk about it? We do. According to Alexander Acosta, he went easy on Epstein because the higher-ups told him he was a part of intelligence. In the book Epstein, Dead Men Tell No Tales, it's asserted that Epstein was a Mossad agent. Mossad is the Israeli equivalent of the CIA or the KGB, or GRU as it's called today. Apparently, Jeffrey Epstein used his sex trafficking ring to blackmail powerful people, mainly politicians and world leaders. That's why every room and every single house he had was bugged. Epstein was most proud of his relationship with Prince Andrew, and he used to call him his Super Bowl trophy. He manipulated the prince masterfully, and he made him think that he was his friend. Some even say Ghislaine Maxwell was a spy under Mossad. Some people even say Ghislaine was a double-triple agent for multiple governments. It's unclear as to how Jeffrey and Ghislaine met. Some people say that Robert Maxwell, Ghislaine's father, introduced the two back in the late 1980s, and the Times have reported that the two met in the early 1990s. What is clear is that the two started dating in the early 1990s. Jeffrey referred to Ghislaine as his main girlfriend, and by 1992, Ghislaine was hiring, firing, and supervising staff that worked under Jeffrey Epstein. Like I said before, Epstein referred to Ghislaine as his main girlfriend, but she was also known as the lady of the house, his best friend, and his aggressive assistant. People close to the couple agree that Ghislaine helped Epstein organize much of his life. Some people say she's also responsible for organizing Epstein's sex ring. Partners in crime until the very end. On July 19th, 2020, a horrible crime was committed. Judge Esther Salas was at home with her son and husband when a knock was heard at their front door. Salas's 20-year-old son opened the front door, and what he found was a man in a FedEx uniform. That man shot Salas's son, and he also shot Salas's husband. Judge Salas's husband survived, but their son didn't. It turns out that the shooter was a 27-year-old anti-feminist lawyer who had beef with Salas. She was his target. Now this seems pretty cut and dry and explained, until you find out that 4 days before, Judge Esther Salas was assigned Epstein's Deutsche Bank case. Can't help but feel suspicious about this. When it comes to Epstein and Deutsche Bank, I don't know, dog. Ghislaine Maxwell's father, Robert Maxwell, was a British media mogul, a member of parliament, a suspected spy, and a fraudster.
Robert was originally from Czechoslovakia. He rose up from poverty and he built himself an extensive publishing empire. He and Ghislaine were really close, and it was said that he was the guy that introduced Ghislaine to Jeffrey Epstein. It was also said that Robert Maxwell was a double, maybe triple agent with ties to MI6, the KGB, and Mossad. In 1991, Robert Maxwell died after falling overboard while riding his yacht, the Lady Ghislaine. Some people say it was an accident, some people say it was suicide, some people say it was murder at the hands of Mossad. Maxwell's media empire crumbled after his death, but he was given a lavish funeral in Israel. Both the PM and President of Israel attended his funeral. Deutsche Bank is a bank based out of Frankfurt, Germany, that's got a pretty shady past. The bank has had some pretty shady clients like Jeffrey Epstein, Russian mobsters and oligarchs, Jared Kushner, and Donald Trump. Jeffrey Epstein received a lot of loans from Deutsche Bank, even though there were a lot of red flags on his account. Deutsche Bank right now is under a lot of investigations because of potential money laundering involving Russian mobsters, Jeffrey Epstein, and Donald Trump. There have been several suicides connected to the bank, like the deaths of these three bankers back in 2013 and 2014. Jeffrey Epstein's own suicide, the murder-suicide involving Judge Esther Salas, and the suicide of the executive that was connected to the loans given to Trump. Not gonna lie, Deutsche Bank gives me the heebie-jeebies. Jeffrey Epstein, being the rich man that he was, had his own private plane. It was a Boeing 727. The plane was a party jet and it hosted A-list celebrities, tycoons of industry, world leaders, and underage girls. The Boeing 727 was dubbed the Lolita Express. According to Virginia Giuffre's deposition, Epstein and Ghislaine Maxwell used the plane to host wild sex parties in the skies. The plane had velour upholstered reclining chairs, love seats, and an onboard bed where Epstein, Ghislaine Maxwell, and their guests had group sex with underage girls. Apparently, everything in the plane folded out and turned into a bed. Currently, the Lolita Express is grounded in an airport in Georgia, and it's up for sale in Florida for nearly $17 million. It's widely known that Jeffrey Epstein ran a sex trafficking ring that was comprised of underage girls. Most people say that Epstein ran the ring to appease his own sick sexual satisfaction, but others say that the ring served another purpose. Some people say that Epstein's island was a honey trap, an investigative practice involving the use of romantic or sexual relationships for interpersonal, political, or monetary purpose. Sources do say that Jeffrey Epstein was a spy for multiple agencies, so the theory that this Craven Island was a honey trap could check out. The thing about a honey trap, though, is that it usually involves one person, either a man or a woman, that's trying to trick an important person into giving them important information. If Epstein's Island was a honey trap, it is by far one of the most brutal and dark honey traps ever set up. We got updates concerning everyone's pair of Satans. Apparently, Ghislaine is being studied by prison psychologists, and she and her lawyers don't like it. I don't know, Ghislaine. Maybe they're trying to figure out how much of a crazy fucking bitch you are. Also, these pictures of Bill Clinton getting a neck massage from one of Epstein's victims just came out. Bruh. This is kind of old news if you consider 3 weeks a long time ago, but Jeffrey Epstein's houses are up for sale. So if you want to own the Hall of Eyeballs, the portrait of Bill Clinton, and the doll hanging from the chandelier, you can get it for the low price of $110 million. And last but not least, a lawsuit alleges that one of Epstein's victims was shown off to Trump at Mar-a-Lago when she was 14 years old. Bruh, let's face it, he knew. It's known that Epstein and Trump have been BFFs since the 1980s. Back then, they hung out and connected through the shady real estate deals they were doing in Manhattan. In the 1980s and the 1990s, Trump and Epstein owned property in Palm Beach, Florida. Now, what led to the dissolution of their friendship was a dispute over property. Epstein showed Trump a house and he outlined a shady real estate deal that he wanted to do with it. Trump listened to Epstein's plan and behind his back executed the deal before Epstein could. Trump ended up selling the house to some Eastern European dude. The house was never lived in and it ended up getting demolished. This pissed Epstein off, so he tried to use Mar-a-Lago to trap Trump in a honey trap blackmail scheme, which ended up with him getting banned.
We got more updates concerning Mr. and Mrs. Pedo. Once again, we have Ghislaine Maxwell's lawyers trying to get her deposition from getting out. This is like the second or third time they've tried to keep the deposition sealed. Oh my God, what is in that deposition? Also, another lawsuit has revealed that Epstein used Bill Clinton's name to intimidate a 15-year-old accuser. What a fucking creep. Dude, can we all agree on one thing? Fuck Bill Clinton. And last but not least, if you've ever wanted to visit Jeffrey Epstein's island, now you can! In Microsoft Flight Simulator 2020. You can go on Reddit, Google, or YouTube to find the exact coordinates of the island. Jeffrey Epstein had dozens of victims, and recently, a lot of them have spoken out and have shared their stories. One of these victims is Maria Farmer. She's been a guest on a lot of podcasts, had interviews for a lot of documentaries. I suggest you seek all of these podcasts and documentaries out so you can hear her tragic story. I also suggest you seek out the work of journalist Whitney Webb. She is a fantastic journalist and has covered the Jeffrey Epstein story extensively. I suggest you read her articles and listen to her podcasts. Now, it's well known that Ghislaine Maxwell was the one that served as Epstein's madam. She'd go out and find the girls for him to abuse. Well, according to Maria Farmer, Ivana Trump was also someone else that procured girls for Epstein. Again, another Trump tied to Epstein. As stated before, Bill Barr's dad, Donald Barr, is the guy that hired Jeffrey Epstein to teach at the Dalton School in New York. Interesting fact about Donald Barr, he actually worked at the OSS, the agency that was the precursor to the CIA. It's been said plenty of times that Jeffrey Epstein was an intelligence agent for many agencies, including the CIA. Some even suspect that the person that recruited Jeffrey Epstein into the CIA was Donald Barr himself. Also, during the time that Donald Barr was the headmaster at Dalton School and Jeffrey Epstein taught there, William Barr, Donald Barr's son, was a part of the CIA. And it's under Bill Barr's watch that Epstein committed suicide. It's a family affair. It's been reported that Bill Clinton first met Jeffrey Epstein at the White House. Epstein attended a charity event at the White House, and throughout the 90s, he actually met with White House aides to discuss financial stabilization. The two didn't get close until after Bill Clinton left the White House. Clinton was actually the one that wanted to be Epstein's BFF, and the reason why was because Epstein had a plane. Clinton had a lot of philanthropy work after leaving the White House, and he wanted to use Epstein's plane to go all over the world for the Clinton Foundation. He also wanted Epstein's long green ducats. Clinton flew on the Lolita Express 27 times, according to flight logs. On the island, Bill always stayed at the orgy house, and according to Epstein, Bill owed Epstein some favors. Prince Andrew and Jeffrey Epstein met back in 1999. Ghislaine Maxwell was the one to introduce them. It's known and there's evidence that Prince Andrew traveled to Jeffrey Epstein's island many times
and that he abused underage girls like Virginia Roberts Gouffre, who's pictured in that picture. Prince Andrew denies abusing anybody, and the royal family is behind him 100%. When asked about the allegations by NBC News, Buckingham Palace gave the following statement. This relates to proceedings in the United States to which the Duke of York is not a party. Any suggestion of impropriety with underage minors is categorically untrue. Wow. The FBI have asked to speak with Prince Andrew, and Prince Andrew has just been like, nah, fuck Prince Andrew, and I hope God takes a shit on the Queen. Jeffrey Epstein donated a lot of money to the sciences. One particular science he was interested in was eugenics. Eugenics is the study of how to arrange reproduction within a human population to increase the occurrence of heritable characteristics regarded as desirable. Eugenics is basically when you genetically engineer a person so they have traits that are better. According to some scientists and businessmen, Epstein had ambitions to use his New Mexico ranch as a base where women would be inseminated with his sperm and would give birth to his babies. Epstein legitimately thought he was God's gift to Earth and he was going to set up a baby farm in New Mexico. Another field of study Epstein was interested in was cryogenics. Epstein had plans to freeze his head and his penis. Jeffrey Epstein, the financial broker, the guy that had the private jet and the private island, was said to be worth billions. But was he really? According to financial records gathered by New York prosecutors, Jeffrey Epstein was only worth $500 million. And apparently he only took in $10 million a year. Also, that mansion Les Wexner gave him, he only bought for $10. And on the market, that mansion is worth $77 million. The fuck? So if Jeffrey Epstein only had $559 million, why did everyone think he was a billionaire? Well, because his lawyer said he was, in a lawsuit. I guess you don't have to be a billionaire to be the biggest pedophile in the world. Aside from that really creepy painting of Bill Clinton, Jeffrey Epstein owned other creepy paintings. This painting is called Femme Fatale. It was painted by the Dutch-French artist Kees van Dongen. It was painted in 1905 and it was worth $5.9 million. This painting of a woman cupping her you-know-what was hung in Jeffrey Epstein's office. This painting of a young man in his underwear watching a young woman sleep on the couch was painted by one of Epstein's victims, Maria Farmer. This painting, according to Maria Farmer, was inspired by one of Edgar Degas' painting called Interior. Here is Degas' painting Interior, the one that inspired Maria Farmer's. Another name for this painting is The Rape. And this painting was found in his New Mexico home, a young girl on a dead lion. How very Epstein. There is a website out on the internet called EpsteinHeirs.com. This website is for people who think they were fathered by Jeffrey Epstein. Knowing Epstein's craven promiscuity, the man could have fathered some children, so there might be some Epstein heirs out in the world. So far, more than 100 people have claimed to be Epstein's children in hopes to get his $635 million fortune. So far, the people that have come forward on EpsteinHeirs.com come from the US, the UK, France, and the Caribbean. So, if you think you were fathered by Jeffrey Epstein, please visit EpsteinHeirs.com to win your very own private pedophile island! A massage board. A portrait of Ghislaine Maxwell. Not this one, of course. They also found photos of naked prepubescent girls. I obviously can't show that. A bunch of sex toys and soap that was in the shape of genitalia. And here's the wildest of them all. In one of his bathrooms, Jeffrey Epstein had a dentistry chair. What the fuck? Around the time Jeffrey Epstein committed suicide, wink wink, nobody really knew what Ghislaine was doing or where she was. It's been said that around August 2019, Ghislaine was living in Manchester by the Sea, Massachusetts, with a hedge fund manager, Scott Borgerson. It was also around this time that these pictures of Ghislaine were taken at an In-N-Out in LA. Oh, Ghislaine, I hope you choked on that fucking double-double, you bitch. When Ghislaine was arrested in July 2020, she was found in this swanky mansion in New Hampshire. When the FBI knocked on her door, she reportedly hid from them. The FBI also documented that Ghislaine had her phone wrapped in aluminum foil. Records also show that Ghislaine is married. Bro, I know she's loaded and she might buy you a PS5, but gross. Now, this is the first I hear of this, but apparently the guards that let Jeffrey Epstein commit suicide are on fucking trial. Apparently, guards Tova Noel and Michael Thomas were charged over Epstein's suicide. These were the guards that failed to do the inmate count and check on Epstein every 30 minutes like they were supposed to. They told their supervisor they didn't check up on him like they were supposed to, but they fabricated reports after they found his body the morning of August 10th, 2019. They were arrested later in November of that year. According to Michael Baden, they were arrested and charged federally because they won't describe the condition Epstein or his cell was in the morning they found him dead. Apparently, they can get up to 15 years for not sharing this information. These poor guards, man. Mark Epstein is Jeffrey Epstein's younger brother. The younger Epstein was an artist before he started pursuing multiple business ventures in New York City. Because of his multiple business ventures, it's hard to pinpoint where exactly Mark got all of his wealth from. He's owned a silk screening t-shirt business, he's invested in real estate, he's owned a charter and leasing company, and in 2005, he started his own modeling agency. That modeling agency, Saint Model and Talent, has no website, no social media, and hasn't signed one model. He's donated to a lot of organizations and charities, and he has a lot of ties to many politicians in Washington. Mark claims his brother was innocent and that he didn't commit suicide, and because of the circumstances of Jeffrey's death, Mark fears for his life. Christine Maxwell is Ghislaine Maxwell's sister. She's actually one of two. She's a twin. She is the twin of Isabel Maxwell. Christine began her career, much like her other siblings, working for her father's publishing company. After her father, Robert Maxwell, died, she founded the IT company Magellan. Magellan was actually one of the internet's first search engines. She sold Magellan for millions of dollars. Christine Maxwell is 69 years old and she lives in Texas with her husband. He teaches at the University of Texas, and she's also a doctoral candidate there at the university. Although it's not confirmed, it is suspected that, much like her sister Ghislaine, Christine is also involved in intelligence gathering. It is the family business after all. Isabel Maxwell is Ghislaine Maxwell's older sister, the twin to Christine Maxwell. Together, Christine and Isabel founded Magellan, one of the internet's first search engines. At first, in the 1970s, Isabel made documentaries. She then moved into the business world. She became the president of ComTouch. She became a technology pioneer for the World Economic Forum, and she helped build the social entrepreneur program in Israel. Isabel has had some pretty interesting marriages. Her first husband was the son of the guy who invented the pill. Her third husband was a guy named Al Seckel, and he was a con man optical illusionist. And much like her siblings, Isabella's also thought of being involved with intelligence agencies. Epstein had a creepy mansion in New York, a pedo island in the Virgin Islands, and apparently he also had a secret lair at a Michigan art school. In exchange for donations and hosting fundraisers at his New York mansion, the Interlochen Center for the Arts, a famed fine arts boarding school for children, allowed Epstein to build the Jeffrey Epstein Scholarship Lodge. One alleged victim is suing Epstein's estate for being recruited at the school in 1994 when she was 13 years old. The music student was abused by Epstein and Maxwell for a period of 4 years. Another student from the school claims that she did spend time with Epstein and Maxwell for 6 years, but was not abused. She did have a falling out with the couple when she refused to recruit girls for Epstein from Juilliard and refused a meeting with Prince Andrew. This guy is Alexander Gerassi. He's Isabel Maxwell's son, and he's Ghislaine's nephew. Turns out Hillary Clinton gave this guy a job multiple times. Alexander Gerassi worked on both her 2008 campaign and her 2016 campaign. Clinton actually gave this guy a job while she was the Secretary of State. Alexander was the State Department's head of Near Eastern Affairs. Alexander did a lot of diplomatic work. He worked on Libya, Syria, and Israeli-Palestinian relations. Alexander was actually the one who was in charge of the Near Eastern Affairs wing of the State Department during the Arab Spring. So that means during Benghazi. Yeah. Also, Alexander started working for Hillary Clinton right out of college in 2007. American oligarchs. The following pictures were taken by police when they raided Jeffrey Epstein's Palm Beach mansion. This is a piece of art that shows a woman in the fetal position, and she looks a little distressed. According to reports, pictures like this were hung up all over Jeffrey Epstein's Palm Beach home. This statue of a crouching person blindfolded was also found in Jeffrey Epstein's Palm Beach mansion. Again, it's in keeping with the whole bondage, torture, sadism theme. And apparently, this is a picture of the dentist's chair Jeffrey Epstein had in one of his bathrooms in his Palm Beach mansion. I know Epstein was into massages, but did he like getting his teeth pulled out? What if he pulled their teeth out? Oh my god. Maxwell is having a hard time in jail. It might be because she's in solitary confinement. Maxwell is monitored 24/7 and she's only allowed 1 hour for exercise. She's also on suicide watch. Well, because, you know. Apparently right now, Ghislaine is wearing clothes that are made out of paper. The clothes are meant to break under her weight. That beats looking like Sergeant Pepper, in my opinion. Ghislaine also complains about being monitored all the time and having no privacy. She and her lawyers actually requested to be transferred into the prison's general population, but her request was denied. I don't know why Ghislaine's actually complaining. She is getting preferential treatment, so to speak. Moral of the story, don't want to be treated like shit? Don't be a pedophile. Ghislaine Maxwell has two brothers, Kevin and Ian. Kevin Maxwell, Robert Maxwell's fourth son, worked with his father until Robert's death in 1991. After Robert's death, it was found out that Kevin helped Robert embezzle lots and lots of funds. Ian Maxwell was involved with that embezzling as well. They both were charged and acquitted on fraud charges in 1996. Kevin Maxwell actually holds the record for the largest bankruptcy declaration in the UK. He claimed debts worth over £4 million in 1992. Currently, the Maxwell brothers run a think tank called Combating Jihadist Terrorism. The group aims to identify the causes of terrorism and prevent terrorist attacks throughout the world. Yeah, that's not weird at all. For months now, the FBI have been trying to get this motherfucker to come over to the States so they can have a little chit-chat with him. You know, because seemingly he diddled children at Epstein's Island. Andrew to this day has not cooperated with the FBI, and it seems to be because he's had a few talks with his mummy. Andrew and the Queen are in crisis talks over this whole Epstein debacle. It's assumed the Queen's trying to do some serious damage control. Now, I don't know about you guys, but if I found out my grown-ass son was a child diddler, I'd probably hand him over to the cops. I'm sorry, but he needs to build some character. I shouldn't ground him. The state probably should. I don't know, but if this is true, fuck the Queen of England. So there have been plenty of people subpoenaed in the Jeffrey Epstein case. We've talked about dumbfuck Prince Andrew getting subpoenaed, but there have been others as well. Some of the people that have been subpoenaed include Jeffrey Epstein's pilots, the ones who flew the Lolita Express. They've been subpoenaed for flight logs and other info like that. Ava and Glenn Dublin have been subpoenaed for financial transactions they had with Epstein. Virginia Roberts Gouffre has actually said that Epstein pimped her out to Glenn Dublin. And last but not least, Leon Black has been subpoenaed in the Epstein case. Leon Black is a very, very, very powerful dude who works on Wall Street. He's been subpoenaed for the same reasons Ava and Glenn Dublin have been subpoenaed, over financial transactions his company had with Epstein. Rich people and pilots. I wonder who else is going to get subpoenaed. According to new reports, it seems that Jeffrey Epstein was bankrolled by his girlfriend's dad, Robert Maxwell. An insider has apparently given lawyers sworn testimony that this is the truth. An insider told lawyers that Jean-Luc Brunel, an Epstein confidant, told acquaintances 20 years ago that Robert Maxwell was the guy who invested in Epstein's affairs early on. This would make sense since there is a story that also says that Robert Maxwell is the guy that introduced Ghislaine to Epstein. After all, when Robert Maxwell died and it came out that he was a massive fraud, who did Ghislaine run to? Jeffrey. Not to mention Robert Maxwell was tied to a bunch of intelligence agencies, and apparently so was Epstein. It makes sense. Doesn't surprise me. So, Julian Assange is facing extradition in Britain. The deep state's trying to get him over here to the States so they can try him under the Espionage Act. If Julian Assange is extradited to the United States and is found guilty under the Espionage Act, that could effectively end free speech in this country. This topic is going to get its own video later. Assange's lawyer, though, argues that he can't be sent to a U.S. prison because he will likely die just like Jeffrey Epstein. Assange's lawyer says that just like Epstein, Julian has a bunch of private and compromising info on a lot of powerful people and is not confident that Julian would be safe in a U.S. prison. So what do you guys think? If Julian is extradited, will he commit suicide? Also, Trump, if you're listening, pardon Julian Assange.